And with that, I would like to introduce our speaker, Dr. Sarah McCowan, who is an associate professor in the Department of Psychology at the University of Victoria. Dr. McCowan's background is in pediatric neuropsychology, and recently she has developed and spearheaded the empirical validation of Dino Island, a tablet-based cognitive intervention for children with neurodevelopmental disabilities. So thank you so much for joining us today, Dr. McCowan.
Thank you. So I will just get to my screen sharing here. If folks can just give me one moment. Hopefully everybody can see that. All right. So yeah, so welcome today. I'm really thrilled to be here to talk about Dino Island innovation and what we've been doing with respect to implementation of the intervention, in addition to integrated knowledge translation and how that's factored into our program. Before getting started, however, I wanted to acknowledge the beautiful lands on which I live, work, learn, and play, and that's the lands of the Lekwungen peoples, on whose traditional territory the University of Victoria stands, in addition to the Songhees, the Squamish, and Wissanic nations whose historical relationships with the land continues to this day. And I always feel so fortunate and grateful to be able to be a visitor on these beautiful lands, especially on a beautiful sunny day like today. Before getting started, I did want to make sure that I acknowledge our partners in this work, and we have an extensive body of key partners. So certainly we would not have been able to do this work without the funding of Kids Brain Health Network, who have been funding this program for well over a decade, right from inception through to implementation. I also, along with that, want to acknowledge Dr. Melanie Barwick and Jackie Brown, who are implementation science consultants that we work with through Kids Brain Health Network, who have been a wealth of knowledge in allowing us to better understand implementation science and in conducting this research. We have some core partners on this program from industry, academia, and the community, Ryan Darcy from Health Tech Connects, Brian Katz from the Center for Child Development in the Lower Mainland, and Robin Woods from Kids Uncomplicated or the Uncomplicated Family in Alberta. And then, of course, I would be remiss if I didn't mention my wonderful graduate and undergraduate students. I have a large lab of students who are integral to supporting this project. Jesse Lewis, John Sheehan, Sunny Guo, Yewon Kim, Phil Burnett, and Busse Badir are our graduate students on this project. Also, we have some family engaged research partners who have been critical to rolling out this intervention with families. Gunjan Seth, Daisy and Martin Doyle, Jesse and Linda Moore, and Michelle and Benji Wan, and they're from areas all across Canada, and they've been working with us collaboratively to develop this program. And then finally, founding partners for the intervention are Dr. Kimberly Kearns and Dr. Catherine Mateer, and they were my mentors way back in the day in the 90s, and really are the originators of this program and have continued to be involved to this day. Before talking specifically about Dino Island, I wanted to talk a little bit about implementation science and what specifically it is. So really the term implementation science refers to the specific sets of activities and strategies that are required to ensure an efficacious outcome from an innovation or healthcare intervention such as Dino Island. This science helps us to determine the strengths and weaknesses within a program to optimize uptake and to improve the overall performance of the intervention. We know that the field of implementation science assesses several different elements of evidence-based practice, which I'll be talking about through our talk today. But essentially, we look at implementation teams, which are the on-the-ground individuals who are implementing the innovation, specific processes for getting going with implementation, factors such as barriers and facilitators that may influence implementation, and then strategies and outcomes that we use to actually implement and measure success. And all of those together really are required for innovation to get on the ground and to improve quality of life and effectiveness of healthcare services, which is our goal in this project. Important to be aware that evaluating implementation or implementation efficacy is not the same as evaluating clinical efficacy, but it is essential for clinical utility. In addition, implementation evaluation is not the same as program evaluation. So program evaluation assesses really intervention outcomes only, whereas implementation science evaluates both implementation outcomes and intervention outcomes. And the kinds of implementation outcomes that are of interest to us are looking at the feasibility of an intervention, its sustainability, the overall impact in the community in which it's intended to be delivered. So it is, we're looking at some fairly specific criteria. Why does implementation science matter? Well, we know that we are all the time developing fabulous evidence-based treatments that stand to improve health and social outcomes for individuals. However, optimal outcomes really require not only that we are establishing clinical efficacy, but that we're also establishing implementation efficacy. And you may be surprised or maybe not to know that unfortunately, most evidence-based treatments that we're developing actually don't make it out of academia and they essentially die on the vine. They're never adopted in the real world, or they're not successfully adopted in the real world, or they're not adopted or implemented in a timely manner. On average, it takes 17 years for an academic-based intervention to make it out into the community. And of course, by that time, they're usually obsolete. I think I've already mentioned this briefly, but again, an important distinction is distinguishing implementation efficacy from treatment efficacy. If we don't distinguish between these two when we're conducting research on new innovations, we really don't know if the innovation fails, whether it was due to the fact that it just was not a good innovation or intervention and it didn't work, or whether it was that it was a fabulous innovation or intervention and it just wasn't deployed or implemented correctly. So really important to understand those two pieces. And in reality, a treatment is not going to be effective. It can be the best treatment in the world, but it's not going to be effective if it isn't something that can be implemented well and successfully in the community. I include this diagram just to kind of talk a little bit about implementation science in an ideal world. So what ideally would we want it to look like? And in the center of the circle there are various components of implementation that are important to assess when we're doing this work. So one component is acceptability. You know, this is about stakeholder perceptions and whether the innovation is palatable or agreeable to the community. Appropriateness, does it seem relevant to the setting or the population? Adoption, so does the stakeholder community intend to use the intervention or to uptake it into their setting? Fidelity, so can the innovation be implemented in its intended way? Feasibility, can it be feasibly used in the setting successfully? And then of course, costs, how much does the innovation actually cost? How much does implementing it cost? And then what are the overall costs and benefits of having that intervention in the setting? And then finally, sustainability. So that's the extent to which an implemented innovation is maintained within a setting once the researchers remove themselves from the equation, which is of course what our eventual goal is. So that's the ideal world. And in an ideal world, you can also do that along with establishing clinical efficacy at the same time, because we know that funds and resources for conducting this type of research are really scarce and difficult to come by. However, in reality, it is actually difficult to establish clinical and implementation efficacy at the same time due to often competing goals or competing methodologies. So when we're doing clinical efficacy work, we're often wanting to do things like randomized clinical trials or randomized controlled trials, which are rigorous, requires a very controlled environment. Things have to be ruled out in a very systematic way. On the other hand, when we're assessing for implementation efficacy, this requires flexibility. So really, we're wanting a naturalistic assessment of how the innovation functions in the real world. And that requires flexibility, adapting to the setting and iterating along the way. And those two things are kind of incompatible at times. In our research program, we've been trying to do both together. So, you know, options to solve this dilemma are one, to do separate studies, do the clinical efficacy research first, and then do implementation efficacy research. And people do that. But of course, that really extends the process and requires more resources for more studies. Another option is to do them together. And then again, you're faced with those challenges of competing priorities. Benefits, however, that of course you're doing it all within the same study, so you're saving resources. You can adapt the intervention or innovation along the way if it isn't working. And it also provides potentially more generalizable clinical efficacy data. So what is the efficacy when this is delivered out in the real world, as opposed to a very controlled kind of lab setting? So in order to do these things together, which is what I'm going to be talking a bit about as we move forward, one of the things that you have to do is to really drill down and identify the core elements of your intervention or innovation that must be in place before you get going. And then around those core principles, there can be some flexibility, but you have to identify these are the core elements that have to be there to be saying that we are doing this innovation or intervention. The second component is making sure to devote equal time to balancing the goals of clinical efficacy and implementation assessment right from the start. So sometimes we assess implementation off the side of our desk by kind of, you know, maybe doing an exit interview at the end or gathering some qualitative data on, you know, informally. But really, if we're doing this properly, we should be planning it from the start as to what our metrics and measures are going to be, and then also giving the process time to unfold, understanding that this, you know, implementation in science is difficult. On average, it takes about 2 to 4 years. So it's going to take time to kind of generate, it's going to take time to do both of those together and to adequately address both. Wanted to talk about integrated knowledge translation and what this is, again, before moving specifically onto Dino Island. And this is really a core aspect of what we do. And what it involves is knowledge translation and information sharing that's occurring through engaging knowledge users in the research process as active participants in co-creating the research. And I think the key word here is active participants. So we want our community partners and our knowledge users to be actively participating and co-generating the research, and we're collaborating together. And when we can do this, I think the benefits go both ways, both for the knowledge user and for the researcher. So, you know, for knowledge users, they may have increased knowledge, increased skills, both with respect to the specific research or innovation that we're doing, but also kind of doing this work in general. They're given voice in generating solutions and ideas. We may have better healthcare outcomes. On the researcher's side, we are certainly much more attuned to the relevance of our research and research questions and the utility of it. So doing research and asking questions that are actually relevant to the population. This facilitates community engagement, which can help with launching additional research programs and then gives sort of ideas for future collaborations. So I think the sharing of knowledge goes both ways. And in my experience, it's actually probably been even more of a benefit for us on the research side than perhaps it is on the community side, at least from my perspective. Again, integrated knowledge translation in an ideal world. So in an ideal world, our knowledge users are involved in the project from the very start of the process when we have the first nugget of an idea, but before we've really generated our research questions, we bring them on. We provide very different opportunities to engage them in the research that speaks to each knowledge user's strengths and goals and priorities and interests. To do this, we need leadership on the project that is both strong and organized, because certainly when you're bringing in so many different partners in the research, there are going to be competing goals and priorities and ideas, which makes it very rich research, but also can be more complex to manage. Really important to set aside sufficient time to collaborate, to build understanding and to communicate and to make sure that we're communicating in a way that makes sense to all different partners. And then again, in the ideal world, this results in immediate practice or policy change. So we've done the work and then immediately we're seeing actual tangible change. And in a reality and in the real world, it doesn't always quite work this way. So first, you know, researchers often have their questions before they involve partners. And, you know, we're applying for grants or we've got very specific questions that we want to ask. So you know, we're sometimes bringing on these partners late, a little bit later in the process. But when this is the case, I think one way to do this is to have partners build off the questions that we're already asking and to generate additional questions that are of relevance to them and to make sure to include those questions. The other thing about integrated knowledge translation is that it takes time and resources. So we need to spend the time to move beyond just lip service of involving community members and knowledge users to active research collaboration. That does take time and effort, both to build those partnerships and to take the time to do it properly. Of course, in reality, it does not always lead to immediate change, which can be frustrating, but that's certainly the reality. And then I guess the other thing that can be challenging in this sphere is that integrated knowledge translation might not always be rewarded by traditional academic structures in the way that a formal science or community presentation might be. I think it's something that is sort of so integral and integrated into our research that it's not always highlighted that this is happening along the way. Although I do believe that it's becoming an area of more interest and that people are recognizing this type of knowledge sharing is really valuable and rich. Okay, so I want to talk specifically now about the intervention or innovation that that we have been developing. So our innovation is a tablet-based cognitive rehab tool for improving attention and executive function in children. It follows evidence-based principles of cognitive rehabilitation, and it's designed specifically for children with brain-related differences or neurodevelopmental difficulties or mental health concerns, most of whom we know have some attention and executive function difficulties. And if these difficulties aren't remediated, we know that they can have long lasting effects and can even lead to secondary disabilities. Within this sphere, there actually are very few treatment options, and most of the options that traditionally have been available tend to be expensive or inaccessible to those who need them the most. So traditionally, they've been delivered in primary care settings or by healthcare providers at great cost and who are difficult to access. So the goal of the overall program was to develop a treatment that addresses the gaps in this area for children, and that's affordable, accessible, even in remote communities, feasible, and of course, clinically efficacious. So Dino Island is a tablet-based game intervention. It consists of 5 mini games that rehabilitate different aspects of attention and EF. So attention, inhibitory control, working memory, flexibility and regulation. It has, along with it, fun bonus games that children do after the therapeutic game to enhance their engagement and motivation. There are computerized attention training games out there, but what's unique about Dino Island is that it uses a hybrid approach that capitalizes on 2 validated neuroscientific approaches to cognitive remediation. So one approach is built into the game, and that's process-specific cognitive training, that where you, if you exercise the brain using masked practice in a hierarchically graded format and in an adaptive format, we know that we can capitalize on brain plasticity to improve or change brain systems and also lead to behavior change. And then the second approach is that we bring into this intervention, which is equally important, is the compensatory approach, where we are teaching individuals or children to work around their difficulties by applying problem-solving strategies and metacognitive strategies. So in this, Dino Island is designed to be delivered by an adult within the child's circle of care, and they need to be present 100% of the time when the intervention is being delivered. And they are teaching the child to learn and apply metacognitive strategies. We have an online training program that's accessible for a range of different knowledge users with different skills and backgrounds. And the program length is we prescribe a minimum of 14 hours to be delivered over 6 to 8 weeks, approximately 3 to 4 times a week. We have a range of different outcome measures. So we assess certainly clinical efficacy through looking at near transfer on related cognitive tasks, far transfer, looking at, you know, changes in behavior, academic skills. And then we're also looking at neural change. So ERP, EEG changes. And then we also have a number of implementation efficacy measures where we're looking at sort of acceptability of the intervention, capacity to deliver it with fidelity, feasibilities, and then barriers and facilitators, which I will talk a bit about today. So just in terms of just a little bit about the history of Dino Island and where it came from. So this actually intervention started with tabletop materials delivered by a rehab specialist. They were originally designed by Catherine Mateer and McKay Solberg in the late 80s, early 90s. And it was designed specifically for individuals with brain injuries who are emerging from coma and scaffolded in the way where we see attention and executive function abilities coming back online when someone's emerging from coma. In the 1990s, Dr. Kearns came on board and she developed materials for use with children. That's this sort of CAPT here. Again, still tabletop materials. And at that time, I was actually Dr. Kearns' graduate student. And I remember delivering it to a little boy with a brain injury, face-to-face across the table. Then to capitalize on the convenience and the salience of video games, Dr. Kearns adapted the intervention into a computerized format. And the first iteration of that was called the Cognitive Carnival. We then, based on that, adapted it into something called the Caribbean Quest, which is where I started working more systematically on this program. That was around 2012. We did validation and implementation trials for Caribbean Quest and identified some key barriers, and then received funding in 2016 from Kids Brain Health Network to redesign it into Dino Island, which is the most recent iteration. So it took from 2016 to 19, we were reprogramming and redeveloping the new intervention, which is based on the same science as the previous iterations, but in a more adaptive, feasible tablet-based format. Then it's progressed from beta testing of the app to pilot testing, to establishing and doing work in the sphere of clinical efficacy, which we're still doing, and then also doing implementation and scaling work. We are also working towards commercialization, which I know is a bit of an evil word in the academic sphere, but really in reality, in order for something to be in the community and accessible to everyone, it has to get out of the research context and out of research funding. And the best way to do that is to think about commercialization. And it can still be affordable and accessible, but it allows sort of a broader community infrastructure for maintaining the intervention. I wanted to talk a bit about our partnership. So through Dino Island, and again, this relates to integrated knowledge translation, we have established an extensive list of partnerships that cross community, academic, and industry sectors. We also have a range of implementation partners, which is critical to implementation science, is that you have these partners who you can implement the innovation with and that reflect different aspects of the implementation journey. In terms of developing our partners, I think they initially came through academic partnerships that were already existing, in addition to our work with Kids Brain Health Network. And we started with, you know, conferences and working with individuals with similar mandates and goals, which is to improve quality of life for children and families with brain differences. And then we kind of built sort of and expanded out our partnerships into communities and industry. And then I think partnerships build on partnerships. So they've just continued to expand from there. In terms of our specific implementation partners and teams, of course, teams are critical to implementation and innovation, and having the right team and an engaged team is really important. Our team, the way I've represented this here, is it comes right from the our closest team, which is at University of Victoria, all the way through to really extended work that we're doing. So original research team is Dr. Mateer, Kearns, and myself, and a range of graduate and undergraduate students who have worked on the project. When we were starting this work and getting into more implementation work, we onboarded some core project partners who have been really integral in moving us towards to where we are at today. So those partners include the Center for Child Development, Healthcare, Health Tech Connects, Center for Neurology Studies, and Kids Uncomplicated. And these have been, these individuals have been involved since 2019 and continue to be involved, ensuring that the research and the development of the program captures industry, academic, and community goals on all of those sectors. The next section here, these are our community-based research partners. So these are individuals within the community who we're actively working on deploying the research with. So there are partners in the research And that includes our 6 or 7 family engaged research partners who are collaborating closely with us. And I think we've learned a lot from them, and I hope they've learned from us. And we've been working and collaborating closely together to make the intervention as accessible as possible. We also have a range of, in this sector, a range of academic partners. These are, include the Mayo Clinic, BC Children's Hospital, Nationwide Children's, University of Calgary, SFU, UBC. We had some original academic partners, and then based on the research getting out there, we had a lot of more partners contact us. So I kind of think partnerships build on partnerships. And then really critically, we have our community implementation partners, and I can't list all of them here, but essentially we have a range of school districts. We've worked with the Learning Disabilities Association, Woodview Autism and Mental Health Services, and of course, a range of different families. And then finally, at the end here, we're doing now some work in Malawi, Africa on this program, and I hope to have a chance to talk a little bit about that today. One of the things I wanted to mention is that doing this kind of partnership work, implementing is challenging, and that partners can have very different mandates and priorities. So on the academic side, we, of course, want to get more funding. We want to produce research. On the community side, community partners want to support their community members individually and holistically. We, of course, want to do that as well, but that's their primary goal. And then on industry side, often the goal is to have a commercializable product. And this can be challenging. And the way we mitigated this is developing a project charter at the very start of the project, where we agreed on a global vision, which was to improve quality of life and outcomes for children. And then we very clearly outlined what each partner would contribute and how what we were doing could benefit them. So, for example, with the Child Center for Child Development, we are supporting their mandate in serving children. We're involving them in research projects that have been of benefit, and we've had extended projects based on that related to our collaboration that have been directly linked with their center and supporting their clientele. With the Uncomplicated Family, we're using their advanced conferencing technology, Teleru, for communicating with families remotely, for sharing information and for conferencing, which has been huge in the ease of the project, but also huge in IKT and being able to share information back and forth very effectively. And we've supported the adaptation of their technology into Teleru too, which is what we find a very effective tool for conducting our work. And then with Health Tech Connects, Center for Neurology Study, we're using their imaging technology, NeuroCatch, in a population and age that it hasn't traditionally been used in, and also extending it out to very remote communities, for example, out in Africa. So you can see that, you know, the partnership does go both ways in terms of their support for what the work that we're doing, and then our support and our sharing of information to help them with their projects and their innovations. With respect to IKT within partnerships and teams, this whole area here that's in the red circle is areas where IKT, integrated knowledge translation, happens with all of our partners. You know, we get a lot of information transferred to us on community needs and priorities, barriers, way to maximize the effectiveness of our research and our program. To community members, we are translating knowledge about the scientific process, knowledge of how to apply these processes to the work that they're doing, certainly knowledge, specific knowledge around attention and EF and children with these challenges. So there's a lot of information sharing that's happening throughout. And I think it's much richer than the information that would just come from simply doing a presentation, because it really is co-created and co-shared and ongoing. Now talking about Dino Island and our process for implementing in different settings. So the initial process of implementing a new innovation requires exploring the setting. So what does the setting look like? It requires installing the intervention or innovation. So the initial installation, how specifically are we going to do it in this setting? And then also actually first trials at implementing it, which again is an iterative process. We usually go through that process several times. In terms of some tools, the HEX tool, which I'm showing you here on the right side of the slide here, is one example of a tool that we've used to find out about whether the innovation is going to be a right fit for the setting. So that would be, is it the right thing to do? And there's numbers of questions, you know, what is the evidence that we have that it's the right thing for them? What is the need of the setting? How does it fit or does it fit? And then on the other side, we have sort of this side of, can we do it in the right way? So let's say it is a fit. Is the organization set up in a way that we can actually deploy the intervention in the way that it's supposed to be done and it's going to still be helpful for them? So this tool we would usually use in upfront meetings and collaborations with the implementation team, even before we get going, to talk about whether really what we're doing and the project that we have is a good fit for them. And then what would be, you know, is it possible to even do it in the right way? So that's before you even get going. The next stage, we usually do something called the drivers tool. This is not related to rolling out the research study or planning the actual study, but it's more specifically a tool for looking at all of the different things that one needs to consider before starting to implement in that setting or organization and whether they have the capacity to do that. So, you know, for example, I've got just, things that we're considering for Dino Island are around research, recruitment and selection, or can they select, the organization select the right people or the most appropriate people? Then training, who's going to do the training? Coaching and supervision, once the trainings happen and the intervention's being delivered, who's going to coach and supervise? Does the organization have the right data systems to inform any decisions about adapting the intervention? Are the administrative systems in place? Are there system-wide supports for the intervention? Technology, for example, is the organization set up to be able to even bring the technology in? Who is going to be the leader on the ground for implementing the implementation, for implementing the innovation at that setting? And then performance assessment, how are outcomes going to be assessed? So we have our own outcomes that we want to know, but for the organization, what are their indicators that they want to use to indicate whether it's successful or not, or whether the cost benefit analysis is worth it? So this, again, we're not planning the study with this, but we're gathering this data just to see, okay, what's already in place? And then what, if we're going to go ahead, might we need to put in place? Which then brings us to the next slide, which is called the practice profile. And this is something that we do once we've decided that, yes, the intervention is a good fit and all of the components that need to be in place to do it are in place or they can be put into place. Then we move to kind of active planning with the organization. And this tool that you see here is called the practice profile. So we will actually, when we're going to be starting, once we've decided to do it, before we start, we will go through this tool with the organization or even with the family if we're working with the families. So in order to do this, again, you have to drill down to the core elements of the innovation. So really those core few elements that must be in place for it to be Dino Island, for example, and that cannot be left out or changed, otherwise you're not delivering Dino Island. And for Dino Island, we have four of those. We have, you know, the interventionists who have to be trained, the people who are going to be delivering the intervention to the child. The child has to engage in game play with the interventionist present. The child has to be receiving metacognitive strategy coaching from that interventionist. And then there has to be some way to track and monitor fidelity. So those are the core elements of the program. And then if we're doing a research study, you can add on these other two pieces. So participant recruitment, who's going to do that? And pre-post assessments. How are we going to do our assessments to look at efficacy and implementation and clinical efficacy as well? So essentially we use this when we're working with a setting to kind of really plan very systematically who is going to do what when. So you have kind of what is the component on the far left here? How is it going to be provided in that setting? Who is going to be involved in providing that component and how are they going to do it? And then how are you going to measure whether that was successful or not? So this is usually, this is just one line of the form, but if we were to use the full form, we have about six different blocks to represent all of those components at the top of the slide. And we work through each one of those. I wanted to talk a little bit about a few examples of our rollout of Dino Island and the steps in the process. So, you know, first, we've done quite a bit of work in schools. Within schools, our first step was, of course, to identify who the teams were in the schools and to identify all of those layers of the teams, because teams are certainly multi-layered. And in a school, there's the administrator of the district, there's the school principal, there's the learning support teacher, who in our case were the people who were kind of the implementation lead on the ground. There's the education assistants, who are the individuals who were supposed to be delivering the intervention. And then there's the children and families who are going to be doing the intervention. So we had to kind of identify all these layers. And in our work, actually, we fell short. We did all of this planning with our planning tool, with the administrators, the LS teachers, the principals, but we never actually drilled down and did this with the educational assistants who are actually going to be delivering the intervention. And so some of the things that administrators, teachers, LS teachers were saying, oh yes, they can do that, were actually not things that they could do easily. So we certainly learned from that to make sure to adequately plan with all members of the team. In terms of the processes, we would have gone through and done the HEX tool, looked at that driver's tool to what components need to be in place and can they do it, and then the practice profile. So again, pulling those core elements of Dino Island out and saying who is going to do what at what time in the schools. What we discovered in terms of facilitators or barriers and facilitators is certainly to do this work, it's critical that there's buy-in at all levels. Of course, you need to know who's doing what, so dividing responsibility appropriately. We discovered there can be tension and conflicts with other initiatives in place, that EAs have limited time, and that even if they are assigned to a particular child, they have a lot of other tasks to do, so it can be challenging for them to fit this into their schedule. Communicating with those frontline individuals and EAs and accessing them so we can individually support them, that's a challenge. An unexpected challenge initially was tech barriers. District firewalls and even getting the intervention up and going in the schools. So how, including the tech person right from the start was really critical. And then school holidays. We have an intervention that's supposed to be delivered for 8 weeks straight, but we usually have a 2-week spring break in there. So how do we manage that? Facilitators, certainly it helps with this work to have a point of contact in the setting who has familiarity with the innovation, and then also champions for the program. So in this work, we essentially assessed fidelity. So by having EAs fill out tracking sheets, by looking at data analytics, by doing check-ins and interviews along the way. We did testing, of course, with children to look at clinical efficacy. And then we also gathered information from the organizational perspective. So looking at capacity building and perspective of the organization. And just in the next slide here, this is some of the preliminary data that we collected, which was basically educational assistants indicated that, I think 72% indicated that they felt a lot of benefits to their future practice. And 25% said a little bit, and then only a very small percent, 3%, felt it didn't benefit them. So this was kind of gains in knowledge and skills that they and benefits from doing the program that they felt would help not just the current child, but future children. And then gains in EA skills, 78% felt they increased in skills. So this is kind of your IKT happening without a presentation or formal talk, but just through active engagement and participation in the program. With respect to implementation with families, again, key to identify your teams first. So teams in the family are not just the child and the parent, but who else is in the context, the organization who referred them. Also our team that we have that supports families. Again, same process is used. So the HEX tool, driver's tool, and going through the practice profile. And what we did here was we did an overall practice profile for families in general, how we thought it would work in homes. But then we did some individual work with each individual family because, of course, each family and their context is different. We did identify a number of facilitator and barriers. So how well does it fit in their family system? Can they actually do it? Accountability, so who is responsible for the components of delivering it? One of the critical factors was relationship with researchers. So critical component was us having an open communication and a positive relationship with families and sharing that knowledge throughout the process. Family culture of delivering interventions, is this something that they're accustomed to doing or is it entirely new for them? And then methods of knowledge dissemination. So how can we most effectively share information with families and get their information? And for this, we use Telaru 2, which again is that really advanced conferencing tool for sharing information and resources. And then of course, one thing we discovered with families is that it is definitely not one size fits all. And we have to sort of adapt this for individual families. In terms of outcomes that we looked at data analytics for the computer. We, from the computer game that sends us how people are doing it. We have family support groups that they do once a week, and we gather information in this way. And then we built into the intervention a self-fidelity check so that families could check in on by themselves on how they were doing, that we didn't have to interrupt them or disrupt them by parachuting in. And certainly we found that we had challenges getting fidelity data when we were asking people to send videos or to, it felt too onerous for them. So we have a self-fidelity check built into the intervention now. We assessed parents when looking at this intervention. So we wanted to assess family implementation outcomes by looking at parents. So we administered the parenting stress index to see if doing it was stressful for them. We administered caregiver quality of life. We looked at goals. Did they achieve their goals that they'd set at the beginning? Parent-child relationship indicators, feelings of self-efficacy. We all looked at all of those factors. We also looked at sort of more feasibility and fidelity factors through our analytic data. And I think we learned a lot. We learned that some of the original methods that we were working using were not as effective, and we now have adapted this to take what we learned and to integrate it more in, and particularly families' voices of what they felt would be most helpful, which is again how they're sharing that knowledge with us. And very finally, last thing I wanted to talk about was the project that we're excited about, and that recently we've started a project in Malawi, Africa with the Blantyre Malaria Project, and this is in partnership with Nationwide Children's and Health Tech Connect Center for Neurology Studies. And this project is being conducted at the hospital within Blantyre. What's interesting about this is the hospitals there run a very different way. So children are admitted to hospital and they tend to be taken care of by ICU nurses, but also by their families. So often their family comes and does all of the caretaking needs. And people are coming to this unit from very rural areas. It's the only hospital even close to the vicinity. So they're coming from remote villages to the hospital for treatment. And this is children with cerebral malaria. So they arrive in coma. They then are in the hospital. They are sent home for a month. They come back for a check-in at 1 month, 4 months, and then 12 months. And there have been very few treatments available for this. And so this team is very excited about this project. And this is my team, along with the pediatric intensive care nurses here, and my training the nurses both on Dino Island and then on using the neuroimaging technology. In terms of, again, this approach, similar approach, first identifying the team. The team in this case was University of Victoria, Nationwide Children's Hospital, Nicole O'Brien, who's the lead of this program, the hospital in Blantyre, the ICU nurses, patients, and families. We went through the same processes using the HEX tool for fit, and certainly there was a need for the intervention with very few other options, and it was very much wanted by the program. We went through a practice profile, so I had two different team members actually fly out to Malawi to bring technology and to do training. So essentially they went over the practice profile with the ICU nurses and the core components of Dino Island and how it's to be delivered. Of course, as you would expect, there were a number of barriers identified in this factors square. So first, there's no internet in the rural communities. And so parents would not be able to do online web-based training, even if they could speak English. So essentially, this was going to be a model where we were training nurses to train parents to then deliver the intervention to the children in their homes. Another barrier, not language speaking, so we had to adapt the intervention to be minimal requirements on English and pre-send some vocabulary tools. Many of the individuals are not literate there, the families, so again, verbal training would be provided by nurses. Another barrier, technology. and no electricity. So we brought iPads, we bought solar panels and brought batteries so that the families, when they take the tablet back to their homes, could charge the tablets and use the intervention. Another component that we typically have used is having somebody check in with families for fidelity along the way. This wouldn't work because families don't have, most of them do not have telephones. So we've arranged for them to call, to go to a weekly village spot where they can call into the hospital and speak with a nurse. Facilitators in this setting, there really are no other treatments that are available for this. The team is highly motivated. And the family's highly motivated. And within their culture, there's a huge respect for medical cares and interventions. So they didn't even feel like issues of having a tablet and returning tablets or would be an issue at all. There's a lot of respect for following the medical recommendations. Of course, we've had to adapt our assessments, and we are assessing children at 1 month. They'll do intensive Dino Island. And then from month 1 to 4, they'll do a more a less intensive program. And then we'll be looking, assessing them at 1 month, 4 months, and 12 months. And this is a 2-year project. And we're hoping year one, which is right now, will give us a lot of information about what is working and not working. And then we'll be able to integrate that into year two. And of course, knowledge translation is integrated throughout that, both us learning about them and their community and really critical information that we need for remote delivery anywhere. And them learning from us about this type of program and treatment and specific skills for nurses and families to help children who have this type of brain injury. And that's 45 minutes. And I think that's it for me. So I look forward to any questions that people might have.
Thank you, Dr. McCowan. I think, you know, just a really incredible like pathway of how this was developed from its infancy. It was adapted to different platforms. It was implemented locally, then it was implemented now across the world, right? Like I just think it's so incredible to see the build, right? That you've taken what you learn and then you continue to build and continue to build, continue to adapt and continue to tweak. I want to ask this question, and I know that there is some literature on this as well, but like you, I think you really hit home. There's certain core components that we cannot lose. Otherwise, it's no longer Dino Island. But at the same time, we're trying to adapt to the local context, and especially in this last example that you provided, so important, right? To ensure that everything's in plain language, that you know you're able to understand. How do we find that balance between having those core components and being able to adapt to the local context? And have you ever had like a struggle where you're just like, oh, but it's really hard to do that in the local context, but we have to have it. So this is a, yeah.
Yeah, it is a struggle. And I would say, you know, because when we put these projects together and we put the research components together, we always have a million things that we think must be done in a particular way in order for us to be doing it. And I think really the key is, again, drilling down to what are the core things that have to be done. So, you know, they need to do 14 hours and they need to do that over about 8 weeks. And we don't want to have a big gap. But do they have to do 30 minutes a day, 3 days a week? Or could they do 60 minutes, 2 days a week? Or do they have to have, and for example, in schools, does one individual have to be with the child one-on-one, or could you have more of a group format whereby you're kind of teaching all of the children about metacognitive strategies and supporting them as they're going? So I think it's really drilling down to, you know, the core elements have to be there, but around that, there is a lot of flexibility and a lot of creativity in how it can be delivered. And the only way for it to be useful or feasible is for it to be able to be flexible in that manner, because it's going to look a little bit different for everybody. So we're still learning about, you know, are there things that we've said we can be flexible on that really are not working so well? But so far, it's been going really well, and we've been able to be both flexible and to stick with some of the core, all the core components as well.
I think that just speaks to how well you've done the patient engagement, right? That they've given that the individuals that you've engaged have given you really rich pieces of advice, suggestions, recommendations, and you've taken them to heart, right? So you've made the right adaptations, but you've also kept very, very much so like strong in your, these things don't change.
Yeah, and I think that's where the IKT comes in, that we're learning from the community as much as they're learning from us. And there's really that wonderful balance. And I think it makes the research and the outcomes much richer.
Wonderful. Thank you for that. Now we have a question on challenges and barriers in implementing, like you said, this IKT in, for example, in Kenya. Have you experienced, I'm going to change the question slightly, any unique challenges and barriers? I know you mentioned a few earlier, but do you elaborate for us?
Yeah, so this is in Malawi, and we've had absolutely some unique challenges and barriers. So, you know, first there is the language barrier, and we are delivering the intervention still, the training and the intervention is in English, but we are minimizing the English required. And we do have the capacity next iteration to adapt and maybe even program it in Chichewa, which is the language they speak there. The neuroimaging technology, we specifically had to adapt its ERPs, and it's based on conflict words. So that was changed into the native language so that we can effectively use those tools. Certainly, you know, this is an intervention that requires a tablet. We originally designed the intervention so that it could be played both on and offline with remote communities in mind, so that, you know, you would have to be online to download it and to upload analytic data, but you can play it offline. So that in this context has been hugely helpful. And then, yeah, families with no internet, no electricity. We've had to bring about 200 pounds of gear over to Africa with solar panels and chargers, which have now become, you know, part of the hospital, and they're going to be used through the hospital for this program. And then, you know, I guess the monitoring piece in remote communities is really challenging when people don't have access to technology, to phones or that kind of communication tool. And the villages are so remotely spaced that we can't have a health check-in because it's not possible for our people to get out there. So we're using this solution of having the family find a friend or a village member or a store where there is a phone where they can call and check in with the nursing team. And they felt that would work really successfully. So it was pretty fun to kind of go through. But when you even going through all of that, we still could see that all of the core components are still in place. They're just being delivered slightly differently in that setting.
Thank you for that. We have one question about the intervention itself and how Dino Island, in the way that it was designed, addresses social emotional learning in children.
Yeah, well, it's not sort of a social program so much, but we have seen positive outcomes on behavioral regulation and social outcomes. And I think it's the way that attention and executive function abilities do support development of those skills. So we've seen gains in those areas, interestingly. We've also seen some increases in communication in kids. So the one part of the program, I think, is improving attention and EF, which does help with flexibility and regulation, which can impact social and emotional functioning. And then the other part of the component, the program, which is the metacognitive piece, is directly teaching children strategies to con themselves, to learn how to focus, to remember things better, get their wiggles out, to manage excess energy levels. So there is a part of the program that's also actively training that as well. And I think with those two together, you're kind of getting both of those pieces.
Incredible. Thank you very much. And I will invite anyone, if they have a last question, to type it in the Q&A. What, if not, I will ask one more.
I can add one more thing, which I didn't mention in the presentation, which is that we are working with the populations that we're currently working with this program are fetal alcohol spectrum disorder, autism. We've worked with learning disorders, children with brain tumors who are receiving proton therapy, children with brain injuries, children with ADHD and other kinds of mental health concerns with attention and EF problems, and children with who born prematurely, and children with congenital cardiac disease. So it's a range of different populations.
Very adaptable. We do have one question here, and I struggle with this myself. So as we know, there are many different terms used in this space, whether that's IKT, research impact, quality improvement. Do you have any advice for anyone struggling with the different terminologies and definitions out there? And how do you think of them, or how do you organize them in a framework in your head?
How do I organize that in a framework in my head? Well, yeah, I would agree that our literature, well, especially in the field of psychology, but also other health-related fields, has very specific terminology, and one would almost venture to say jargon as well. And I would say that actually one of the hugest benefits of integrating knowledge translation and working collaboratively with community partners is figuring out ways to describe these in real person words. And I probably didn't do a good job of that today because I was doing it quickly and rushing through things. But really kind of working with those community partners, that when I was talking about having a shared language, that was what I was kind of referring to, is coming up a way to kind of think about these things and describe these things in a way that it has meaning to everybody while avoiding some of the jargon and acronyms. Because I do agree, it's, you know, there's so many of them out there, and they may have meaning for a specific discipline or a different term in a different discipline. So I think it's more just drilling down to what is the essence of it, and trying to use that accessible language.
Thank you.
It helps me to understand it better when I think about it in that way versus memorizing terms.
Yeah, and you bring a beautiful point up, which is, you know, in lay language, how would you describe this, right? Well, from the patient perspective, from the community perspective, from the caregiver perspective, how would you describe this?
Yeah, so, and also from the perspective of different cultures and groups that we're working with, how did they describe it in their own language, right? So, yeah.
Well, with that, Dr. Macoun, thank you so much for bringing this real world, tangible example, you know, from the beginning to where you are now. We are so excited for you. And yeah, we just want to thank you for sharing your time and expertise with us.
Well, thank you. Thanks for having me today. It was a pleasure to talk about what we're doing.
And with that, everyone, for more information on knowledge translation, to explore supplemental resources, or to share or watch a recording of this, please visit the Michael Smith Health Research BC website, shown on screen. And then we're going to encourage you to join us next month for our session with Dr. Skye Barbic. Do I tweet, post, or dance? The role of social media in the meaningful mobilization of health research. And finally, we would like to thank everyone for joining us. And we invite you to have a wonderful rest of your Friday. And you are now free to disconnect. And we hope to see you soon. Goodbye, everyone.